Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Herbon Mosteller HR Solutions.
Hi, my name is Alyssa Francis. I'm a Human Resources Specialist at MISCO Products Corporation. I've been a member of the National SHRM organization and the Berkshire SHRM chapter for about 4 years. My favorite thing about the local chapter is the learning opportunities that it presents. Every month we get the opportunity to attend our chapter meeting, and there we hear a presentation about hot HR topics, and we get to learn new things each month. We also get to attend lunch and learns on a quarterly basis, which also provides additional learning opportunities. These opportunities are great because they keep me on top of HR issues that are happening, and it keeps me knowledgeable for the benefit of my organization. If you're an HR professional or a business owner, I highly encourage you to check out the local SHRM chapter. Thanks.
Good evening. My name is Bob Orzechowski, and I am the host and producer for Human Resource Management. Welcome to the program tonight, Tuesday, September 13th. It's 6 p.m. This is our 104th program and our 17th year bringing the HR management concepts to employers and employees in our area, in our viewing area. We certainly want to thank our underwriter, Herbon Mosteller HR Solutions. They're a full-service professional consulting company, and they have numerous offices in the area. You can reach them at 610-779-3870. Their contact information will be available, again, at the bottom of the program, www.mostellerhr.com. And we thank them for their support. The program tonight, employee rights and discipline. It's a never-ending subject, and it's full of twists and turns, as you'll see tonight. And our disclaimer, of course, nothing's here meant to be legal advice, and the opinions of the panelists are our own and not necessarily those of our employers or of BCTV. And speaking of panelists, we are fortunate tonight to have Beth with us, Beth Ebersole. Is an attorney with Blakinger Thomas Law Firm. She's focused on, we can't say specialize, I learned that, in civil and commercial litigation and employment law. She served in the United States Air Force and the Air National Guard for several years as a logistics readiness officer. And she was also selected as a U.S. Department of Transportation honors attorney. You'll have to tell us what's involved with that. I've never heard that before. And she spent several years in the outside labor and employment council to one of the nation's largest privately owned corporations. So she's seen the good, bad, and ugly, I imagine.
Sure. Not everything, though, right?
Well, welcome here, and we'll have to learn about the honors attorney. I guess it's some special designation. I want to talk a little bit about BCTV and bring their mission to light to you out there in the viewing audience. To enhance the unity and strength of our community by providing a medium for information, serving, sharing, and forum for idea exchange. Our programs are streamed online at bctv.org. And our replays are Friday at 8 p.m., Saturday at 1 p.m., and Wednesdays at 9 a.m., in case you're interested. I have to give a plug for our Berks County chapter of the Society for Human Resource Management, under whose auspices we bring you these programs. And we have the Society itself is national, the international organization, been around since 1948. They have about 300,000 members and maybe 500 chapters. They're in about, 10, 15 countries, maybe more by now. And their resources are, if you're in the HR profession, they have tools and resources for you, professional journal, access to advisors. They have an advocacy organization as well. And their value proposition is significant. The dues are somewhere in the $200 range a year, but the value you get far exceeds that in worth. The chapter, 179, we've been around 50 years as of last April. We regularly receive Excel awards, platinum level awards in the SHRM organization for all the good work we do. We run a certification program for those professionals who wish to pursue that rigorous achievement. We're in community service with BCTV, with the Olivets, used to be the Police Athletic League down there on 4th and Walnut, I believe. And so we also have a job fair that we run up at Reading High School for the students. Monthly meetings, we just had one today. It's valuable networking. And today we were lucky enough to have an attorney do his annual legal and legislative update, where he goes through cases from the Supreme Court down to the circuit courts and whatever. And some of the cases are just interesting, but it's all about the details.
Always is.
We have a student chapter at Alvernia University. And our mission, of course, to empower HR professionals to improve their workplaces. And if we don't do that, we certainly fail as professionals. So let's move into the program. But first, if you could share with us what's involved in being an honors attorney.
Sure. So for those potential law school individuals who those who want to enter into law school or are thinking about a law school career, just about each federal government agency has what they call an honors attorney program. And so these programs are offered to third year law school students. You have to apply early, so earlier in your third year in the fall. And
that's your senior year.
Essentially, it's equivalent to your senior year, correct. So what you do is submit your application. There's Department of Justice, Department of Transportation is where I applied. And I think for my year, there were about over 1,000 applicants at that time, and they had 10 spots.
Talk about competitive.
Sure, it was very competitive. I'm not sure how I got selected, but I did. And so I was supposed to roll that into a long-term career. So it's 2 years where you rotate through every section of the DOT. So I was in the Office of General Counsel, where we worked with the Solicitor General in cases presented to the Supreme Court, where DOT was an active party or had an interest in the case. From there, I moved to NHTSA, the National Highway Transportation Safety Administration. I always get that. Hopefully, I got that right this time.
Really? That's a tongue twister.
Is a tongue twister. And then the Maritime Administration. So that deals with ships, the U.S. ships, wartime activation of ships, and things like that. So it provided me quite the breadth of experience. Unfortunately, or fortunately, my husband was active duty Marine Corps, and so while I was supposed to transition into a permanent role in the federal government, he received orders to Hawaii, which is where I practiced for 2 years in the nonprofit sector.
Aha. Uh-huh. Well, that's not such a bad duty station, though, I guess.
It has its perks,
of course. I think as long as you know it's temporary, it is on an island out in the middle of the ocean.
That provided me with some stress, a little bit, yes, to get to anywhere... It was about 6 hours over the water. So if you don't like flying, especially over water, I wouldn't recommend traveling there.
Yeah, I don't think those planes float.
Last time I checked, they didn't.
Yeah.
No.
Well, we're really happy to have you with us tonight. And this could be one of the more sensitive topics we deal with. I mean, when you're talking about health insurance or OSHA, and some other issues, they can be less exciting. They can be pretty prescribed. But rights and discipline, and every time I see that, I think of, I have three children, they're grown now, but you try to put that in perspective with their behavior and discipline or rewards and all that. But if you could, frame this for us, the difference maybe between statutory and contractual rights. Well, we'll get into more specific examples in a little bit. And then there's the public sector and the private sector, and some are unionized and some aren't. What's the right framework to discuss this topic?
Sure. So if we perhaps start out in a larger perspective and then whittle down,
okay,
with public versus private sector, if you are a government employee, whether it's a federal employee or a state employee, of course, you have different and sometimes additional rules that apply to your employment that wouldn't often apply if you were employed in a private company, right?
And the private sector can include for-profit and not-for-profit companies.
Correct.
Not-for-profit doesn't, even though the government's not supposed to be profitable, but that's public sector.
Correct.
Okay.
And so you mentioned unions, and those can be in private sector, in the private sector, but of course they would have separate and distinct rules that would apply to their employee-employer relationship. And I understand that we might not dive deeply into that tonight. It is quite extensive. We could talk the rest of the hour with regards to that. So we look at the overall perspective, your public employment versus private employment. If we break that down even further, most of the questions that I receive from clients, both on the employee side and employer side, is the question about at-will employment versus contractual employment, right? Where an employment agreement is in existence between the employer and employee. So at-will is where an employee can be terminated at any time for any reason that's not discriminatory or otherwise illegal.
Any legal reason.
Any legal reason, right? I always caveat that,
yeah.
Or no reason at all. Conversely, the employee can terminate their own employment with the company if they no longer desire to work there.
Well, you know, I used to teach college at night as well, and one of the HR courses, and I came across the story of employment at will, and I hadn't realized it myself, but after the Civil War, prior to the Civil War, there wasn't a lot of employment. There were no national employment policies. Most everything was handmade. There weren't a lot of big factories. If they were, they weren't very nice. And so with the Industrial Revolution, there became this tremendous demand for labor, and all these immigrants just piled into America, I guess. But there was no national employment policies, so it developed that if you didn't like where you were working, you could go get work someplace else. Somebody would hire you, and if the employer didn't want you there, they also could do likewise. And there was an attorney, oddly enough, named Woods, who postulated Woods' Rule, which was just that: an employer can terminate an employment relationship with anybody they want for any reason, and of course we didn't have all the statutes we have today. But likewise, so can the employee. If they don't want to work there anymore, they can leave. And that was Wood's Rule, and it became known as employment at will. And I find it interesting that we have now gone full circle in many states where you actually have a right to your job.
Hmm.
So it's an interesting concept, but There are exceptions to it. If you could just address the exceptions and the restrictions. I mean, if the employer asks somebody to commit a crime and they refuse, they get fired. That's probably not going to hold up. And is it true that employees have a statutory duty of loyalty?
Yes, even without the existence or creation of an employment agreement, which would essentially be a contract between the employer and the employee, there would still be an obligation for the employee to remain loyal with regards to the business operations, any particularly sensitive confidentiality, customer
business
lists,
secrets,
business
like,
secrets, right. Intellectual property, if you will. We often have customer lists, customer names, their contact information that work with that particular employer, right? And so for an employee to then terminate their employment and go to another company, that could be a breach of their implied duty of loyalty.
What about if they stay working there, though? That has, because I rarely hear or see, it's almost like employers don't realize that their employees have a duty of loyalty. They'd almost take it for granted without even articulating it. But with the employment at will, then, there's, I don't know, is the phrase industrial justice, something like due process, like we're not just going to fire you, we're going to do progressive discipline, that sort of thing. Is that play with this?
So I always, when I hear employee discipline, I always think, what's in the handbook? What is contained in the employer's handbook, and what does that progressive discipline look like? And are you equally applying those disciplinary steps to every employee in an equal and just way, right? There's no disparate outcome or disparate application of the disciplinary procedure, if you will. So certainly it is essential for employers to have a handbook. Not every employer has an employee handbook.
Gasp.
Much to our chagrin, right? For the employer, to routinely and regularly update their handbook, I always recommend at least an annual review of the handbook and its terminology.
Well, what do you look for? I mean, how do you know something when you drive your car, you don't really realize that something that like the fan belt's too thin or the tires tread is worn. You don't realize it until something bad happens.
Sure, and I think that's why we would always recommend having an employment attorney on hand, because even if the employer hasn't experienced all of these terrible things that have happened previously with their employee, certainly an employment attorney would be mindful of things that could go awry and should be aware of any pertinent updates to the law, especially, for example, with the COVID pandemic that has stricken the country and has made employers really reevaluate how they conduct business, especially with remote working with their employees.
Well, where do we sit then with me? You must have been involved in a number of cases, whether you like the outcome or not, of employers that didn't have a handbook. And I don't know if you can comment on any of them, or they had a handbook and it didn't do them any good for one reason or another. What would you tell the employers? Because there are people listening who are not only employees, but there is also business owners out there that have maybe 5, 10, 15 people working for them, and they have many of the same pressures and concerns. And I mean, we treat every patient possibly as a potential lawsuit, but we also look at every employee and every applicant as a potential lawsuit. And we're just sensitized to it. We're not fearful of it, but we've tried to be as prepared as possible.
Sure. So the employer having a handbook or having policies, policies in place, perhaps it's not a 150-page handbook. Perhaps these are policies that could be a page or two, but that equally address your disciplinary items, your paid time off, how is it accrued, how is it taken, how is it approved. Certainly maternity leave, paternity leave, right? That's now becoming a major right in some employer.
What size employer does that cover? It won't go down to 5 employees, will it? Are we talking FMLA maybe?
Right, correct. Yes. Yeah. So it's not mandatory until you have at least 50 employees or more. For those smaller shops that have, 5, 10 employees, of course, the federal law doesn't mandate providing those benefits, However, I think we've all seen how competitive the job market has become.
Incredible, isn't it? I don't know anybody who's not looking for people.
It's crazy. I mean, you walk down the street and I saw at least one sign, two signs, and I only walked a block and a half. So certainly, there are tremendous opportunities out there. And of course, I would encourage and advise employers to make themselves as marketable as possible. They have to be open and receptive to those benefits, maternity leave, paid maternity leave, paid paternity leave, remote work options, where in environments you thought that it might never have been possible. I'm pretty sure we've experienced that the last 2 years to show that it is feasible.
Well, we were talking earlier, and I kind of greased the wheels for this one, but with remote workers, wherever you're working, you could be Aspen, Colorado, and that's where your winter home is or something, I don't know.
I wish. Is it your winter home there?
No, not mine either. I luge in bobsled, but I won't get on skis because trees don't move. And you the physics of the game of the bobsled keeps you in the chute. It's really difficult.
I don't trust it, Bob. I still don't trust it.
You have to virtually try to do something dumb with it, and you've got milliseconds to do it. So, I'm not as worried about that. It's terrifying, of course, but. And I tried snowboarding maybe when I was in my 50s, and that darn near killed me.
I haven't tried snowboarding. I only first learned how to ski last January, and it was mostly me rolling down steep hills. So I understand how you feel.
It hurts. What I was going to ask you is, we got off on the wrong foot there, can employers require their home workers to have their cameras on for meetings? Maybe not to follow them around the house and have a camera in every room to be sure what they're doing or not, but at least for the Zoom meetings, because you can tell if they've done the work they were assigned because they turned it in. Mm-hmm. But meetings are a whole different story, and I need to know that you're there, just not to see a name on a blank screen. This is untried yet and unheard of, I guess. It hasn't seasoned its way through the regulatory or legal process.
Not from what I've seen, and certainly that specific question has not been presented to me yet, and I'd be interested to hear if there was anyone else out there that has dealt with this exact circumstance. And as a matter of initial impression for me, I would equate requiring an employee to have their video turned on, for example, during a Zoom conference, as a reasonable requirement. I would equate it to having the employee be present in the office and interfacing at meetings and attending in person. As an employer, you want to ensure that your employee is engaged, is interactive, is prepared. And I think we all can agree that seeing a blank screen without hearing anything or anyone is a really ineffective way to make sure that your employee is doing what they should be doing during the hours they're supposed to be working.
Mm-hmm. It's such a new thing, but could you recall for us any kind of cases where employee rights were the source of the issue, the crux of the concern? We're not talking about contracts where maybe there's some kind of mandatory consequence violating some confidentiality or restrictive covenants, and injunctive relief. That's not the crux of the issue there. You couldn't go work for that employer, and you did, and I'm going to sue you for it. But just the sheer rights that an employer was just maybe a bit too aggressive, and ought not to have been that. There might have been a better way to handle the problem, but it wound up in court, and of course you were there on one side or the other.
So I can't think of a particular case off the top of my head and naming it and telling you the circuit.
We don't have to name them.
Sure. So, you know.
You can protect the innocent. My
or the guilty.
Or the guilty.
Right? So my mind automatically goes to accommodations, requests for accommodations. And I think reasonable requests for accommodations go hand in hand with an employee's right to be an active participant in a workspace while still being respected, whether they're differently abled or they need particular requirements. And I'm not sure if that's where you were going with that, but I do think they go hand in hand. And so, of course, there is a plethora of cases out there, even particularly in the Eastern District of Pennsylvania, where they address the breakdown of the interactive process when an employee asks for what could be considered a reasonable accommodation.
Well, not every employee's need is obvious to an employer, mm-hmm. especially an untrained manager out in the loading dock. You know, that's the last of their concerns, I would think, day to day. So you spoke, and the interactive process is critical to it. What should employers do when employees, when they suspect that an employee might be a covered individual, and what is it, the ADA is 10 people, 10 employees? I don't know the exact numbers you do. But what's the employer supposed to do here? How do they, I mean, it must be terribly awkward for them.
Sure. So, of course.
I think you're disabled, and I think you have trouble staying awake, and so what can I do to help? I just can't see it coming down that way.
Sure. I haven't come across any case law or personal experience that requires an employer to be clairvoyant about their employee's potential disabilities, right, or perceived disabilities. So we're not asking an employer to read other people's minds or predict or anticipate, right? But we are asking or advising employers to be mindful if an inquisitive, but not, it's a balance, right? I hate to say, of course, go ask them, what's your problem? Why are you falling asleep? But certainly always be receptive when an employee approaches, whether it's HR or their immediate supervisor. I always encourage that management chain to take every request seriously and every dialogue that possibly refers to an employee's difficulty in a particular situation.
We're going to pick right back up on this in about 60 seconds. I think we're going to go to a break for a moment.
Hi, it's great to be part of Berks Sherm, to be able to interact with clients and colleagues who are mainly HR professionals coming here and listening to the programming and being able to learn about the ongoing facets of HR. As everyone knows, it changes every day. I like to come here and support them and be part of the ongoing community development as far as what we do with those HR professionals. So Sherm helps me stay relevant on the topics of the day and really communicate with those colleagues and clients that are out and about in the HR world.
All right.
Okay, we are back here at Tuesday, September 13th, and we're in beautiful downtown Reading in the new Alvernia University building. We're on BCTV program, HR management, and employee rights and discipline. And we're here with Beth Ebersole, an attorney focusing on concentrating. That's the word
sure.
I was looking
concentrating.
For.
Concentrating, sounds good.
On employment law, and we were looking at employees' rights to have reasonable accommodation for virtually any need. With the American with Disabilities Amendment Act, it pretty much, if you think you're disabled, that's enough, and that's okay. But with so many employers looking for people at this point, I think it's critical that they take a broader view of the employees. They might not get the perfect physical and mental specimen anymore. That's just not going to happen. And so how do we as employers protect ourselves is the right word, at least stay out of court, to stay out of the newspaper, because employees have so many protections, if that's the right word. I know of a tragic case where there was an employee, another wasn't our company, it was a larger company, in fact, with a large HR staff, and he was exhibiting all the signs of being under the influence of, the thought was, alcohol. Hmm. And as it turned out, through the disciplinary process, it never surfaced. He was an undiagnosed diabetic, same symptoms. And it didn't get terribly combative or ugly in any sense of the word, but it was terribly unfortunate because nobody knew what they didn't know at that time. And I guess that can happen to anybody, but if you could speak to the, what kind of rights can we, how do we articulate that in a handbook? It would be 1,000 pages to do that. So how does the employer protect themselves, if that's the right word, and not run afoul of the employee's rights and still manage the business and manage the staff and all that?
Sure. So before I answer that, I am intrigued. Did they walk back the progressive discipline that they had issued to the employee?
Oh, yeah. They did 90 degrees.
Okay. Happy to hear.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they did the right things. It's just that nobody knew. And so through the investigatory process, and referrals to an EAP and all that, it kind of percolated to the top, but it was so subterranean, no one, because I think they had already had some substance abuse issues in the company. And so management or line supervisors were I wouldn't say they were the culprits, but they were the first to pounce because they witnessed it. Come back from lunch and you're a bit goofy guy, you know, that kind of thing.
Sure, and I think that informs my answer to your prior question of how do employers protect themselves while also ensuring that employees' rights are equally recognized and protected. So, of course, you said that there was an investigatory process commenced, and through that process, they determined that perhaps their initial impression of potentially having an employee be under the influence was incorrect.
I think they had a good substance abuse policy, and it was like a, it wasn't a zero tolerance, and there were no signs of any, you know, self-harm or harm to others kind of an issue. It was more, we can't have this in our plant. I mean, there's equipment here,
sure.
There's stuff.
Safety.
You know? And that was the main tack they took. But if it's one thing, whenever I see webinars on for HR people on how to conduct investigations, I make it a point to participate in them just because there's so many different kinds of investigations. And there's so many subtle points to it that, and it's not something HR does every day, so we're weak at it as well. There's nothing intuitive. You want me to do job descriptions or performance appraisals or new hire interviews, piece of cake. But what happens when somebody comes in and says, I've been discriminated against because I've read where like 3/4 of the EEOC cases anymore are retaliations. They're not the discrimination. What are these employers thinking? I mean, who's their counsel on all of this? That just shocks the conscience.
Sure, and I think you have HR professionals, managers, supervisors, wherever they are at in the chain of command, if you will, that perhaps believe they're doing the right thing. And, you know, they're doing the right thing for the company, for the employer. And so move confidently and boldly in the direction of eliminating the bad apple, right? And without their due diligence of conducting an investigation, asking questions of the employee, asking questions of the colleagues of the employee, you put the employer in a dangerous situation where your liability and potential risk of lawsuits increase exponentially, right? So it's essential to ask those questions, not jump to conclusions, not assume, well, one time, 2 years ago, he acted funny this way, so of course now it's the same thing, right? We don't jump to conclusions in life, or we shouldn't. And I would always advise employers not to do the same thing.
Well, that would be, we've had cases already where, or situations where it was neither severe nor pervasive, but still offensive. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's a customer, or in some cases a patient, that they're a customer to an employee. It's not employee to employee. And it's the same concept though, right? Mm-hmm. The employee, because the employer, their first duty is the general duty clause of OSHA in safety and safe from harm and all that. What's the HR people supposed to do when an employee comes to complain and says, I don't want you to do anything about this, but I want you to know what's happening? Where do you go with that?
Putting them in a tough spot, right? So I love a good paper trail, personally speaking. I would love to see that documentation, whether it's a memo to file, whether it's the HR, if it's one person or a larger office, sharing with their colleagues who have that same arc of responsibility within the organization, and memorializing what occurred, but also ensuring that the employee asked not to divulge this information, but to put the company, to put HR on alert.
Is that file discoverable, or is that attorney-client?
Well, it wouldn't be attorney-client if you didn't engage an attorney to provide.
That'd be the first thing I'd do is call your fellow.
Sure. Yeah, and so then of course it does become a matter of attorney-client privilege. Okay. The correspondence back and forth would not be discoverable. And for those who aren't familiar with the litigation terms, discovery is the process where the parties exchange information and documents and are required to produce anything and everything that is reasonably would reasonably lead to admissible evidence in a court of law. So that's pretty broad and all-encompassing. However, the exception would be any attorney-client documents, correspondence, communications exchanged.
But of course, I think in the natural course of events then, I've always tried to address that almost impossible request with an employee, only because if there's an issue, letting it go is the worst thing you can do.
Sure. And, you know, I realized what I'm about to say puts quite the burden on the HR administrators. HR professionals, I have all the respect for those individuals. They handle so many things, so many issues. You have to have people skills, all of these things. Their plate is full, right? So anyone listening to this probably would say, yes, my plate is currently very full. But I would suggest following up with that employee, touching base with that employee, making them feel that they were heard and that they're seen and that the employer does in fact care about their well-being and are actively seeking ways to engage and accommodate without the legal terminology associated with that.
Well, we had one of the topics to discuss tonight was the concept of disparate treatment and disparate impact as it applies to discipline and other decisions. Could you go over that briefly?
Sure. So disparate treatment, I think we all kind of understand the general meaning of what disparate treatment and disparate impact is. It can happen, and it has happened, and it has been litigated quite extensively when an employer, for example, institutes a policy, for example, let's say a dress code that all employers must adhere to, and it seems to be equally applicable to all employees, regardless of their position, but it has a disparate impact on particular employees. And I would say this, probably most of you have seen in the news headdresses. There have been state laws that have been implemented that recognize women or men's right to wear garbs, headdresses on, you know, on their heads or
like
have...
Like a Sikh or whatever.
Yes, and yeah. I'm not, please forgive me, I'm not quite familiar with the specific terms of everything that that could consist of, but then also wearing your hair in certain ways, you know, as the individual's preference. So the business code, of the business dress code, if you will, could unintentionally eliminate an employee's ability to wear a hat or scarves on their head or any headgear, if you will. And then, of course, we have to think, well, if this person is wearing, if you said the Sikh on their head for to practice their religion, right, then that certainly would result in a disparate impact to that employee. And at that point, I would say...
They become a protected individual?
Correct. Okay. And at that point, I think, and it has been shown throughout case law throughout the United States, the employer has an issue. They have are treating an employee differently, even though this policy, this business dress code, was supposed to apply equally to every employee.
Well, I know when we came up with, when COVID came out with a mandate, with the thing with COVID is novel meant novel. Nobody knew what they were doing. And with our operation, we mandated it if you were going to have patient contact. Otherwise, you had to still be masked and gloved or whatever, but you didn't have to be vaccinated. And it was a real wrestling issue for us that whether to mandate 100%. Or, and then the religious exemption came out, the sincerely held religious exemption, and people were saying, well, I'm going to make a religious exemption on it. And I actually heard this because part of the vaccine was made with fetal tissue.
I've heard that as well.
And that's that was their sincerely held religious belief. But when I had a 7-page policy drafted and we wanted to know if there were icons, if there were ceremonies, if there were holidays, if there, and they had to prove, you know, the burden of proofs with the positive assertion. So if it's sincerely held, prove it. And it became a tug of war. Fortunately, the vaccines came along. Employee rights. A right to a break in the work schedule.
Sure, absolutely. That is an employee right and should be, again, implemented and reflected in some type of policy that is consistently applied.
Well, I know there is for women in a maternal state.
Yes.
I know that, and there's the nursing mother law. But absent that, they have a right to a break. I wasn't aware of that.
So it is encouraged. So for example, I dealt with cases where you work in a factory, right? Mm-hmm. And you are at a machine and you are actively operating the machine between 8 to 12, right? So you have your lunch break.
We're not talking about potty breaks.
We're talking about an opportunity to go to the bathroom, use the potty, but also take a step back, focus on something else, reset, and then come back and be engaged, especially when you're actively working in right. environments where there are safety hazards
sure.
with the machinery or whatever else you're
doing. You want to maintain a state of alertness.
Correct. And mm-hmm. I think we all can agree that I think scientific studies show that the a person's ability to be focused is very finite, right? Even, you know, an hour, can we do that? Can most people do that? So certainly when you're considering something where you are operating a large machine, to expect that or to demand that for 4 hours mm-hmm. straight, and then, okay, you can go to lunch, seems a bit unreasonable and certainly would be.
Right, and I'm glad you framed it that way, because that's always been my position, that maybe we don't have to give you a break. And if we do, we don't have to pay you. But why would you take that position when you want people to be alert and refreshed? And I can certainly see that. What rights do employees have to keep the employer's interest at heart with off-duty conduct?
Yeah, that's a tough one, especially when we have social media out there, right? You know, I have dealt with a lot of employers who have social media policies in place, but I always advise the employer that you cannot broadly constrain an employee's speech in off-duty speech on social media platforms. In a way that would infringe upon their right to free speech, right? So
is that the same for public and private employers?
So I would certainly say that private, you know, you caught me in a question that I'm not 100% confident in giving you an answer, though I would imagine the First Amendment right to free speech is viable for both public and private sector employees.
Well, I believe that in the public sector, you can wear political badges. But I don't know if that can't be prohibited in the public in the private sector. That is, I think in the public sector you can do that, or maybe it's the reverse.
I think it's the reverse. So the private sector, in terms of your off-duty contact, certainly, I don't think there's any employer out there that would legally and legitimately be able to constrain their employee from voicing their political beliefs or concerns or otherwise sharing their thoughts and feelings on social media or in the public in general. Whereas in the public sector, not to be confused with the public at large, in the
right.
public sector, working as a federal
county courthouse, state
sure.
Harrisburg Capitol building.
And so I can use a personal experience, right? Not just my professional experience. When I was a federal employee, you had your long-term federal government employees that did not change with the change of the political regime. And then you had your politically appointed employees that would change. They were nominated and then thrown into the federal government agency for as long as the executive administration thought, or not the executive administration, but the presidential regime, if you will, was in place. So during my work day, I was not necessarily permitted to voice my political beliefs, whether I agreed or disagreed with the current administration in charge of the Department of Transportation. But certainly off duty, I could still actively participate in whatever, you know, political
right.
affiliations
now,
or otherwise.
Even if it was on duty, where does protected concerted activity come into play then?
Sure. So we've seen this in with Amazon, for example.
Right,
If you recall, it was probably in the last year, they had employees, was it New York State or possibly New Jersey, who were trying to gather the masses to encourage to form a union of Amazon employees.
Mm-hmm.
And so you know, I think that's still being played out. I'm not sure where Amazon stands. I know that there's been dialogue, and I haven't kept up with it. But that would, for example, be considered protected concerted activity not to be able to limit this employee discussing their rights with other employees.
Okay. We have about 5 minutes left. What are some of the takeaways that employers should take away from a discussion of rights and discipline for their employees? Because I don't know any employer gets out of bed in the morning and thinks, how can I get stupid today?
Sure. We all have the best intentions, which this saying comes to mind, best intentions lead to, and I'm going to lose it. Hopefully right. You can pick me up on the end. No? No, you can't. Okay. So the takeaways from this.
The path to hell is paved
yes,
with good intentions.
Thank you. There you go, Bob. Yes, you pinch hit for the win. All right. So I would say consistency always with your policies, with your discipline. Always be mindful of your consistent application, right? I would say also, I know it's very difficult for us to do, but pulling the emotion out of your application and your interactions with colleagues and with employees, because sometimes that emotion doesn't guide us in the way that a non-emotional evaluation of what our handbook or policies
that
say.
That is, if I had to name one skill that if you want to go into HR, you need to have a level of emotional intelligence.
Yes.
At least as great as anybody else in the company, and then some.
Absolutely.
Because it's the thing you can never do is lose it.
Absolutely. And that, in my experience, is what leads to troubling situations.
Because then you get into bad decisions.
Correct.
And one last thing with personnel records. And employees have a right in Pennsylvania to see their employment records. There might be some constraints, but they have a right to do that.
Sure. So the Pennsylvania Inspection of Files Law allows employees to access and review their personnel files on an annual basis.
Okay. Now, I don't have to keep everything in that file for them to see, though. There's things that maybe they're not entitled to see, like maybe reference checks that were given under the guise of confidentiality, results of drug tests.
Sure, yes. There's a reasonable exclusion of okay. those confidential
but
documents.
But they do have a right to see it, and I don't want tomorrow now for 500,000 employees to go to marching into the HR office demanding to see their file. Don't do that, please. But no, it's one of those things. It's always a mystery. I know when I got my father was also in the Marine Corps, and I got his files just to see to get information to make
yes.
a shadow box.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really pretty boring when you think about it. I mean, maybe
super boring.
Yes. Okay. Well, I think in the time we have left, I need to take a moment to express my deep appreciation for you coming all the way in here. My panelist tonight was Beth Ebersole. She's an employment law attorney with concentration, of course, in commercial litigation and employment law with Blakinger Thomas. Did I say that right?
You did. You got it.
Whew. There should be an E in there. It tells you to use Blakinger. Otherwise, it's Blackinger. But anyway.
Well, I'll submit the request to
yeah,
Mr. Blakinger
I'm sure you have
himself.
A suggestion box.
Sure, we do.
Sure.
I'll let him know.
And we'll certainly hope to have you back sometime.
Thank you.
I want to thank our underwriter, Herbine Mosteller HR Solutions, the full-service professional HR consulting firm. They've been around for years. They have a huge footprint, and I know many of them well. They're colleagues and friends. Can certainly heartily recommend them. And their office is out on Morgantown Road, 2433. You'll see the information up there. And we also want to thank the people here at BCTV behind the cameras and in the control booth, Joan and Emily. Well done, ladies. Thank you very much. Certainly our Berks County Chapter 179. If you are interested, you don't need to have HR in your title to be a member. You do have to have a legitimate interest in HR as a profession because we are a professional organization. And that information is up on the screen for you now. You can contact our administrative director at berkschapter179@gmail.com or get on the website berkspa.sherm.org. And you can learn all about us and check us out there and see if it can meet your HR needs. And with that, we have another program coming up on Tuesday, November 8th at 6 to 7 p.m., 1 hour only, folks. And with that, we will say good night.
Being a Sherm Berks chapter member has offered me many opportunities, both personally and professionally. The network time at the beginning and end of the monthly meetings allows everyone to get to know each other, share funny stories, exchange HR topics and issues, and just build camaraderie. The contacts that I have made through the Berks Sherm chapter are contacts and friendships that will last a lifetime. During my tenure with the Sherm Berks chapter, which started in 1999, I have served on the board of directors, on the Sherm Aid team, advocacy team, as well as been a certification facilitator. I strongly encourage anyone to join Sherm Berks chapter.
Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Herbon Mosteller HR Solutions.